Today I'll be presenting authentication network for instance segmentation. So let's start with what is instance segmentation. So in computer vision there are multiple problems. One is image classification. Deriving from that, there are multiple problems: object detection, instance segmentation, object detection, semantic segmentation, instance segmentation, panoptic segmentation, and key point detection, etc. We will not discuss any of those. I will just motivate the problem in instance segmentation by comparison with semantic segmentation. In semantic segmentation, given an image, in semantic segmentation, you just have to predict class-wise scores for every pixel, where all the pixels here will be 0 and your foreground pixels will be 1. But in instance segmentation, you have to you have to specify exactly your background will still be 0, but you will have to specify not only the class labels per se, but also that this is a separate instance and this is a separate instance. Like even though the class may be the same, both are person class, you'll have to specify that this is a separate person and this is a separate person. Where in semantic segmentation, they both are considered the same. I want to, path aggregation networks. So there are two motivating papers. One is Mascar Sena, and the second one is feature pyramid network. Let's go through Mascar Sena very quickly. So Mascar Sena is based out of faster RCNN. In faster RCNN, what you have is given an input image, you compute certain features, on those features you will compute object proposals, and given those object proposals you will pass those object proposals to an ROI, a region of interest pooling layer. That region of interest pooling layer, you will have a separate you will have two heads. One is your classification head and one is your regression head. Your classification which will do your classification and regression of the learning boxes. Now that is faster RCNN. In Mascar Sena, Mascar Sena tries to extend that architecture of object detection to instance segmentation. They do it simply by adding a separate mask branch, where already you have your box branch and you already have your box branch and classification branch. You simply add a mask branch to it by adding like four combination layers, and then you predict pixel k masks for every category. So that is Mascar Sena. I just want to go through, one issue with Mascar Sena is that the major issue with Mascar Sena and why it was not why you couldn't port that to, let's say, for semantic segmentation and instance segmentation is because of the ROI pooling layer. Now I just want to briefly explain, and this is why, like, the major motivation why Mascar Sena works really well is because they replaced this with ROI aligned layer. I just want to briefly go through this because this is like the major. So ROI pooling, given your assuming this is like 800x800, and this is your object proposal. In the feature map, it will be like, because of the non-sampling layers, you will have your feature map size will be very, it will be 32 times, let's say, lower than the input dimension, right? So, let's say you have an object proposal which is 665x665. Now, if you divide this 665 by the value, you get something like 20.77 something. Now the problem is that you will, in ROI pooling, what happens is, since they're not, they will just quantize this to like 20. And so your object proposal on the feature map will be a quantized representation of this object proposal box. So here there is one level of quantization, and once you have this object proposal here, let's say this is 20 plus 20, you want this because you want to pass it because ROI takes, let's say, 7 plus 7, you have to map it to a 7 plus 7 grid. Now if you do 20, if you do 20 by 20 divided by 7, this is still a floating point number. I know this is, but some floating point number which you will still quantize. So you're losing, like, there are two levels of quantization which end up losing information. Now a question that you might have is, when you're quantizing, it's like 20.76, you're just quantizing to 20, right? You're bringing up like a fraction of quantization. But the problem is that the proportion of this, when you're took this, is, let's say, like 1 pixel in the feature map corresponds with what, 32 pixels in the actual image. So that is a lot of information that gets that is lost. So even like a 0.76 fraction makes a huge difference in the original images. Now, so this is ROI pooling. In ROI aligned, like the only major difference is that they don't do quantization on both these aspects. They just keep the floating point numbers. And now the question becomes, like, how do you, since it's a fraction bit, since you're not doing any quantization, like and you want, let's say, 7 plus 7, so how do you do that grid, right? Because it's not possible. So they just do bilinearly interpolate the floating point numbers from the nearest 4 pixels or like some pixels. So this is like the major motivation. This is like the major reason why because they don't end up losing any information on the mask, it performs really, really well. So this is like ROI. Now I want to quickly go through feature pyramid network, FPN. FPN is a very generic method used in most object detection networks just to improve accuracy and to better localize and to make better use of features. FPN just introduces so these are the feature maps. That's P1, P2, P3. It just introduces, if you consider this a bottom up pathway, it just introduces a top down pathway where these features go through a 1000 conversion, and then you produce another set of feature map, and you have a few more conversions, let's say a 3x3 count here, and you produce this feature map, but you concatenate this feature map to the other feature map, to the previously generated feature map. So that you're making use of higher level features also, but also you're concatenating your low resolution features also. So that's two
ways of uses what cost.
Yeah. For the higher, like, if this is the bottom up pathway, if this is, let's say, C3 and if this is P1, to get the P1 feature map, you go 1x1 and you just have this, and then you perform, let's say, 3x3.
You do only concatenation, right?
Huh?
You do only concatenation, right?
Concatenation of
features in P1.
Concatenation from that.
C3 to P1.
No, you pass it through a 1x1 and then you get this. I don't think any concatenation is, I don't think any feature addition is.
Addition or concatenation? Addition means what you're saying is that I want
to.
This is not FCL, it's talking about feature probability.
No, but that is. He's asking whether. No, I think it's addition, not concatenation. What was your. Yeah, we do 1x1.
1x1 and
After doing ultrasound, we get that second, we get that what top down pathway highest region. So that is like two lines of FP. Now coming to path aggregation. So okay. So let me give you two. This is the image. So this is FPN, like I mean this is like any regular framework where you have you go through multiple foundation, you add a lateral connection, you have another top down or bottom up pathway. Now they make the argument that what you need is shortcut connections from. You need more. You need another. This just a bottom up pathway is not enough. They add a bottom up. They argue that just a bottom up pathway is not enough, and you need a bottom up pathway with more augmentation on it. So what they end up doing is they create a separate, like one more edition of, let's say an FPN network. Or one more layer, you can call it, I don't know. They pass through, like they have skip connections from like from your first to like this hierarchy, so that you're not losing, like they so that they can pass on like low level, your high resolution high resolution low level features to your topmost high level features, in the sense that because these contain because for just to motivate again, because these are instant segmentation, semantic segmentation tasks, you need like spatially very accurate localization of objects and instances. So even though this might contain like object level features which might tell you what is a person, what is an object, like object level features, you want to spatially like properly understand where exactly in the domain they are, in the feature they are. So they add like shortcut connections to this, and they also build this feature. They also build like another layer of FPN, you might call it. So here they just do. So here they build it in the sense. So here you do a 1x1 here, and then you do a 3x3 with stripe 2, which will give you a downsampled feature map. And for that, from that you can get you add this feature map, and then you get a then you do one more 3x3, and then you get a new feature map. Just to explain again, you take this feature map, the lowest left, the lowest one, and then you do a 3x3 with stripe 2 on that, which will give you a downsampled feature map. For that downsampled feature map, you add the previous feature map, which is higher on the previous layer.
But there is 1x1 comes in.
From this to this.
So.
You're just taking, here there is no, I don't think here there is 1x1. You're just taking this feature map and you're doing 3x3. So you give you this feature map, you go 3x3 with strike 2, and then which will give you a downsample feature map on which you add this previous higher level feature map, and you go 3x3 again, and then you get the fresh, like the P3 or P whatever. And this you do until you reach the topmost level of the feature map. So this is called a bottom-up path augmentation. This is one of their this is one part of the network that they use. The second thing they have is adaptive feature pooling. Now, in what they end up doing is, so in regular feature pooling network, how they propose object proposals is that they if an object proposal, they have like, they look at the size of the object proposal, and if the size, let's say, is small, then they, if the object proposal is small, then they might place it on the high resolution, like, if the object proposal is small, they might place it at high resolution feature maps, and if the object is large, they might place it on the, like, low resolution, like, they compute the size of the object proposal, and then they place it on, different feature pyramid layers. Now that they argue that that's not a, even though it's very intuitive to place small object proposals in like larger feature maps and smaller feature maps, they argue that that is not an optimal way, because let's say if you have an object proposal which is small, and you're placing it on high level FPM. But if that is just 10 pixels, if you just increase that by 10 pixels, you will still place it in the same one, even though they are very similar. You might place it at the same one or different one. So what they end up doing is, for they place object proposals in every layer, and what they do is that after placing them in every layer, they take the element wise max in all the feature maps. In all the FPM layers. Is that clear?
But the size is different, right? Like how they do element wise max.
You're doing element wise on ROI or on ROI pooling, so it'll be the same.
This is the pooled one.
On all FPM heads, it doesn't like your output will be.
So the window size is the same for all.
Window size will be same. I mean, even though the ROI is.
So
I don't understand the question actually.
So see, different feature permits has different window sizes, right?
Yeah.
The ROI is different, right?
Mm.
So how do they combine it?
Summation or addition doesn't happen here, right? From here you get a ROI, you do a ROI line, right? From which you get a fixed size feature vector. Let's say 7x7x256.
Okay.
And from that you take a element wise max or element wise summation of.
But like what is adaptive in this? adaptive bullying is what is
adaptive? I mean, instead of placing at so in FPN, like previously the scenario was that you would just you have an intuitive, like if an object proposal is small, like let's say if the size of your if the size of the object proposal, let's say, is like 3x3, then you probably place it on like high level feature, like on the top feature head. And if the object proposal was, let's say, 27x27, then you place it as place it at like bottom.
This is which step?
In FPN.
Oh, they do that.
They calculate the the size of the proposal and then accordingly place it on. Like their intuition is that if a proposal like is small, then placing it at higher level feature pyramid head will give you like better context. It'll take better advantage of the context present in the topmost feature pyramid head. And if it's a lower and if the proposal is large, then you will take advantage of like your low level feature. So that instead of doing that, they just place it across all the heads.
Mm-hmm. But what adaptive, like something it will learn to place it or like where?
Not sure actually. Not sure. By learning, there's nothing that's being learned. The only thing is like, so here after all this, like
you as in weights or like directly fuse it? How do you?
So here you will have, after you get your ROI, then you have a fully connected layer. You have a fully connected layer here, but I don't know. So they fuse it after. So every ROI goes through a fully connected layer independently. And after that, they do a fusion operation. Is that clear? So you have ROI for everything, right? You have ROI vector for every feature parameter. You have an ROI vector. You have a ROI feature map. Now this goes through one fully connected layer for every feature pyramid head separately. Here there are some parameters. And from here, you do a fusion operation. You take the element wise max.
Okay, for each that dimension of the vector?
Yeah, here the dimensions are fixed, right? So from here, you do a element wise max. So here,
what is the ROI size? That then that should be fixed, right?
Here, everything is fixed.
What is it? That window is fixed.
ROI features are by definition fixed.
How much?
7x7 or 5x5 or
like how many layers does it like just one dense or how much?
This is one dense.
Yes. Single dense?
Yeah, 1048 over single dense. And here you have a fusion. So this is like, this is the adaptive feature pooling. Yeah, like I mean, few things to keep in mind. You're getting region of interest. You're getting regions from all feature pyramid heads. So, and also when they take that max, like you're getting information from information that is like which will help you in like which has like high resolution features here and like object level features here. So because you're doing it on all heads, so that helps.
Hey, one more thing, like you told the max element wise max, where does that happen?
After this, like here they take the max.
Output is a segmentation map, right?
No. Output is not a segmentation map.
The end output, what is it?
I'll come to it. This is just a vector. This is a conf, like not a. It's a n cross n cross something.
If you're taking component wise max of say three vectors, would it give a better vector?
But yeah, you're right. But I don't think this is a vector. Let me just check.
I think after that we have a acceleration.
Yeah, this is not a vector. I mean, this is a vector. This is not a, like, it's just a vector. And from here, like you have your box branch and class branch. Once you fuse this, you have like one more FC here, and then you have like a box branch and a class branch.
In figure 6 they have mentioned.
Yeah, figure 6 they have mentioned.
This is FC1 of FC2.
Okay. Now I want to move to. Is this still here? Is this clear? So now I want to move to. Your mask. How they mask it? Now this vector they reshape. Now they make they reshape this to like let's say I think 20x28. So I think if I'm not mistaken, this is a 784 dimension vector. This after you finish your take after you do the fusion and the max, you get a 784 dimension vector. From there, what you have is you have a series of cons and. Let's say from conf 3, what you have is another series of cons, and then you have a fully connected layer. And then you have a summation. So for the mask branch, what happens is, one thing that they do which is different from mask RCNN is, in mask RCNN you just have a, for the faster RCNN branch, they just add a, like four comp layers and then they have a binary output, right? But here what they do is they also make the four, like three cons plus one decons, but they also add a separate path, which is like two cons. Then they have a fully connected layer. Now, their motivation for, they, like their argument is that having a fully connected, having a fully computational network is good for predicting binary masks. But also, they say that by adding fully connected layers, like in fully computational network, you usually have like one filter which runs through the spatial logic feature map and then it generates the other feature map, right? But the weights of that the weights of the filters are shared. Now, in fully connected in fully connected network, it's spatially sensitive, right? Because every like every element in the vector of the FCI of the fully connected layer will be location sensitive because it does not share weights with it does not share weight with every other location, right? So it tries to utilize make use of the spatially sensitive part in the fully connected layer, and so that they do here. And once they do that, they reshape this to let's say 28, and then they fuse. So they make use of not only the FCM weight sharing, like inherent, which is inherent in FCM fully connected network, but they also do fully connected to make location sensitive feature of fully connected layers. And then they fuse that to get the mask branch. Any questions here? This is straightforward.
Where is it? Class information comes like that mask will have.
So the mask will be k m squared, like m cross m with k dimensions. Like every channel will like. It will be a binary mask. Even your fully connected layer, fully connected also will only compute foreground and background. There is no, it's class agnostic. Yeah, I just want to, like, ablation wise, so when they use so when they use bottom-up path augmentation, they get like mask, so mask AP and box AP increase by approximately 0.6 and 0.9. When they use fully connected fusion, their mask improvement improves by 0.7. So like ablation-wise, they're pretty good. I mean, it's pretty resistant to results. Yeah, like, so this is mostly it. Questions.